Greetings, everyone. It's a couple minutes before we're starting. We're starting in 5 minutes, but one of our lessons today is Ecclesiastes 3, all about it. There's a time for a season and everything. And so many of you know the song Turn, 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 and that's half of our lesson. So I just thought before the service started, I just want to play a video of that just to kind of get it in our minds before we read it. Okay, so it's written by Pete Seeger, by the way, many years ago. So we'll start it and see how it goes. Thanks. But you can still talk if you good to know that you can just write songs too that are right from the scriptures, right? From Ecclesiastes chapter 3. So thanks for good singing to some of you as well. So we have a special Labor Day service today. Thanks for being here. Welcome to the new people. John and don't tell me Ruth are here, brand new, and Ivan and Marie, I think it is. Yeah. And others. I can't meet everybody, but I'm Pastor Ken and John. Everything you need is right here. And whenever we go on a trip together, we always share pictures and slides, and we usually go in the spring and the fall. And then when I go on my own, I go up north for my birthday, but then I go camping on my own up in Eveleth and on the range by Virginia and Gibby. And so I just want to share just a couple pictures because I want to thank you for your prayers, because the weather was a little bit tough at times. So I had my sturdy house I lived in here, which was my tent. Okay. And I sent this picture to Pastor Jeb, and he goes, "I have a tent exactly like that." But I also had plan B, and that was the back of my car. And there's my sleeping bag. So Monday night, storms, wind, blowing, you name it, I was sleeping in the back of my vehicle there in my sleeping bag. But the good news is my tent didn't leak, so thanks for your prayers. And it didn't blow away either. It's pretty good. I had a chance to do some fishing. There you go. So Sunny's top left, and then cleaning them. It's a messy business, isn't it? But it's a blessing to cook them and then have red licorice for dessert. That's really important. And so I went up and down the coast of Lake Superior, thanking God. I went way up to Grand Portage, which is 10 miles from the border, if you know. And so there's the Grand Portage Marina. There's a whole bunch of recreation vehicles there. And there's a campsite, Jonah Land Camp, there too. It's beautiful. Went down to Grand Marais. When we were young, we took our kids camping a lot, and we went up to Grand Marais. We stayed at Lamb's Campground at the Municipal Campground, and we said to our daughter Leah, she's 4 or 5, we said, "Get ready, we're going up to Grand Marais." And she goes, "Who is Grand Marais?" She never met her, but we're always going up there. There's a bay there. It's a beautiful shot I took. Just the sun coming down. And it was windy, but it was beautiful and sunny. Went all the way down to Duluth, just a couple more slides. And I like this shot because I waited until the freighter in Duluth was coming in the lighthouse, and there was the horse and buggy special. And lastly here, maybe least, maybe not, depends if you believe. Did you guys believe that I saw 2 sightings of Bigfoot? Does anyone believe that? Okay. Well, I just pulled up to this Holiday gas station in Tofty, and I'm just sitting there on my phone, and all of a sudden, I look to my right, and I'm lucky I got shot, and then he just went right by and just kept trucking. And then I kept going to Duluth, downtown Duluth on Canal Street. And I'm walking along, and there he was again, right there. And I thought, oh my gosh, what are the odds? Yeah. Do you guys believe that? It takes more faith to believe in this than that Jesus died and rose for us, doesn't it? You can't see it, but on the bottom of the sculpture, right at the bottom there, it says, the sculptor said, "I believe in you." That's what it says. So God bless him. It takes great faith, and that's a nice transition to our lesson today. Thanks for your prayers and a good week. As we gather for this Labor Day, what it's all about, the observance of Labor Day gives us an excellent opportunity to address the manner of our daily work from the biblical perspective. Whether we are an adult active in the workplace, a student returning to school, a stay-at-home parent, an empty nester, entering retirement or beyond, each one of us is doing our own special labor throughout each chapter of life. And this is our prayer today. Our prayer for this service is that in each task given, we seek to hear the call and the opportunity to serve our Lord. So every chapter of our life, like our opening song in Morning Prayer. I rejoice. from Isaiah, I will be your God throughout your lifetime, until your hair is white with age. I made you, I will care for you, I will carry you along and save you. That's so beautiful. Sometimes God carries us and sometimes he gives us the strength to carry others, right? Thank God for that. So we continue with our invocation. And this beautiful song we're going to read responsibly together. We continue in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us declare the greatness of God. He set the earth on a firm foundation,
and nothing shall ever shake it.
He blanketed the earth with oceans,
and covered the mountains with deep waters.
He started the springs and rivers,
and sent them flowing among the hills.
Meanwhile, men and women go out to their work,
busy at their jobs until evening.
He calls us to be his servants,
caretakers of his entire creation.
Oh, let me sing to the Lord all my life long.
Sing the hymns to my God, as long as I live.
Amen. Our confession and absolution. You know, we don't go to a hospital because we're well, we go because we're sick. We don't come to church only to rejoice, but we also come to confess. We ask for forgiveness so we can go out and forgive others, right? With God's forgiveness that he gave us. So I shall begin. It's only by the power of the Holy Spirit that we can confess and believe in God. And by his power, we can daily die to our sinful nature and choose to serve the Lord in him only. Let us then confess our sins to God, our Creator, and merciful Father. Most merciful God, we are workers, God, just like you, but we confess that our actions do not always affirm and honor each other. Our work is not always done in the spirit that is pleasing to you. Forgive us for failing to remember it is you we are serving. Hear our prayer, and in the mercy of Jesus Christ, cleanse us for his name's sake. I love this, as you believe, so let it be, at the command and promise of our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm happy to announce to you that all our sins are forgiven in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And before we sing our next hymn, Created Me, I forgot to mention this to John, I just wanted to take about just a few minutes and mention the background of this song again. And I know some of you know the story, some of you don't know the story, some of you maybe forgot some of the details. It's so good because when we sing the song, Created Me, in just a minute or two, it'll help us remember how David felt when he wrote Psalm 51. And you can read for yourself 2 Samuel chapter 11 and 12. 11, you can read, leads up to 12. And the prophet Nathan confronts David regarding his adulterous relationship with Bathsheba and cover up of their affair. It's not just covering up the affair, it's covering up the murder that David had her husband, because she became pregnant. And so David had her husband killed in battle. And he was a great warrior. In fact, David, when he found out that Bathsheba was pregnant, King David, because he took her for his own, even though he had everything that God could possibly give him, even other wives and everything, you know. So what did God do? God sent him the prophet Nathan to confront him of his sin. And by the way, you might know this, but you can read it in 2 Samuel 11. Because she became pregnant, David was kind of like, what should we do? So he had her husband Uriah, great warrior in battle, come home from the front lines where they're fighting in war, and come home hoping he'd sleep with his wife. But he was so honorable as an officer that he refused, while his men are in battle, to be home drinking and sleeping with his wife. And the next day, King David even got him drunk, but still he just slept outside the door and wouldn't go in. And so David, as some of you know, went to his general commander Joab and said, please take Uriah, put him in the front of the lines where the fighting is the worst, so he'll be killed. That's what he did. And so Bathsheba's husband Uriah is killed in battle. And so now God sends Nathan the prophet to David to confront him. You're kidding me, David? And so how do you confront a powerful King David? Well, you tell him a story. You tell him it's a true story, David. Did I tell you this story of my king? Yes. There was a rich man and a poor man, and the rich man had hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of sheep, but the poor man only had one little lamb. And the lamb stayed in his house, and he was like a daughter to him. And when the rich man had his friend that visited him, instead of taking one of his herd, of his hundreds of sheep, he went next door and took that little lamb and slaughtered it and gave it to his friend. And when David heard this, he got so upset, and he said, "This man deserves to die." And then Nathan looks at him and he says, as many of you know, "David, you're the man. You are the man. God gave you everything, and then if you needed something else, he would have given it to you. But here's, you took this one woman, and then you had her husband killed." And David, he just breaks down. In fact, because of that, the child dies, and then the second child is born with Solomon. But David, after this, he writes, it says, "A Psalm 51, a Psalm of David, when Nathan the prophet went to him after he had gone into Bathsheba. And I won't read all this, I mean, we could sing it now, except that one line that says, "Creating me, third line, a clean heart of God, renew a steadfast spirit within me, do not cast me away from your presence, do not take your Holy Spirit from me." And then about four lines from the bottom, "Restore to me the joy of your salvation and uphold me with your generous spirit." Ecclesiastes 3, "There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens. A time to be born, a time to die. A time to plant and a time to uproot. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones and a time to gather them. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to search and a time to give up. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to mend. A time to be silent and a time to speak. a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. What do workers gain from their toil? I have seen the burden God has laid on human race. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the human heart, yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know that there is nothing better for people than to be happy and do good while they live, that each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their toil. This is the gift of God. I know that everything God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it and nothing taken from it. God does it so that people will fear him. And of course, fear in the best sense means awe, respect as well. So praise God. Our second lesson is the Gospel of John. And the very simple thing, if you want to know what it means to do God's work, it means simply to believe, as we know. But it says it so simply here. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me, not because you saw the signs I performed, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For on him God the Father has placed his seal of approval." Then they asked him, "What must we do to do the works God requires?" Jesus answered, "The work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent." Here ends the last one. As it says, all things are beautiful in his time. So is our next song. Enjoy the work. If you read King Solomon, David's second child, Bathsheba, who it says the Lord loved Solomon, and talk about when he was a young man, he had to lead the people. And his prayer, young Solomon was, it wasn't for wealth or fame or riches or anything. His prayer, you can read it, says, Lord, this is such a great people you've given me to rule over. All I pray is that you give me an understanding heart, you know, to rule them. And then God answered and said, Solomon, because you didn't ask for all the rest, I'm going to give you, you know, wealth and power, wisdom, wisest man. Jesus even commented that in the Gospels. There wasn't someone like him before. And so God blessed King David of Bathsheba, right? Amidst it all and all that sadness. But it's God who's the worker. And as some of you are gardeners here, I know, it's like you're doing farmers, some of you grew up, you know, that's God's first job, wasn't it? Not only his work, creating, but then Adam and Eve in the garden. So right back in the second chapter, the heavens and the earth were completed and all their hosts. By the seventh day, God completed his work. So God's doing work, which he had done. And he rested on the seventh day from all his work, which he had done. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work, which God had created in him. We've been to Israel a number of times, and you always see, any time during the day, you'll see Muslims get out their prayer mat right on the ground. Traffic is going everywhere. They're facing Mecca, and they're praying five times a day. That's what Muhammad asked him, the prophet asked them to do. They celebrate their kind of the Sabbath on Friday, you know, early afternoon, mostly for men, but women are go, but they reach their home with the family and stuff. The Jews celebrate Sabbath on Saturday, right? And we Judeo-Christians celebrate Sunday the Sabbath. And I really like that. I like all that, but I like that. It says in Matthew chapter 28, on the very early in the morning on the first day of the week, the women came to the tomb and found that the stone had been rolled away. The first day of the week, the resurrection day, is Sunday. We always celebrate resurrection. This is really our beginning of our week as well. And then so on day seven, I like that God rested from his work and gave us an incredible example that if God should rest, what should we, right? And then, that's Genesis 2, 1 to 3, and then Genesis 2, 15, the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and to care of it. Isn't that great? You know, this is before the fall. This is before everything went to you know where. And they're just enjoying their time. They're loving it. They're tilling the garden. They're enjoying it. You know, it's what God created us for as well. Many of you lived through the Depression and the Depression years. Joan's mom, Joan's dad, and my mother were born in the same year, 1925. And my mother passed away 2 years ago. But, you know, 4 years from the Great Depression beginning, 29. But then many of you after that were children of the Depression, weren't you? And did you realize a quarter of the whole country was out of work? And when I drove up for my birthday up to Itasca Park, and then 113, I take a left, right there is this beautiful kind of, maybe some of you have seen it. It's this big sign. And if you look a little closer, it's called the Civilian Conservation Corps, Loveless Lake Camp. I'll read just the first few sentences. On April 5th, 1933, with a quarter of the national worker force unemployed, President Franklin Delano Roosevelt signed the executive order establishing the Civilian Conservation Corps. Young men on public projects and earned $30 per month that to support their families. So they were able to keep $5 and send $25 home. And if you read the rest, it says there were 100 miles of roads that they did, enjoyed their work. And if you've been to Itasca Park, and many of you have, and other parks, in you know, old parks, you'll see, you'll see those old buildings that are still standing, that they're still being used, those huge nice bricks and stones, so great. Praise God for enjoying their work. So for everything, there's a season. That's why I love Minnesota. My only prayer, I love all the seasons. My only prayer is, Lord, I just wish there were 3 months to each season, right? You know? I wish spring lasts as long as summer, and summer lasts as long as fall, and fall lasts as long as winter, you know, kind of thing. Is that too much to ask? Maybe God says, well, if you want that, you can move to Colorado or Missouri or some other place. But we do love it. I'll speak for myself. I love it. It's about, for me, seriously, Virginia, it's 5 months too long, I know that. But for me, it's just about 1 or 2 months too long, and I won't speak for Joe. But don't you love these seasons? You know, the spring, the summer, the autumn, and the snow. In this message, I'm going to share one of my books, and I'm going to share some of my pottery, not because I'm pushing books or pushing pottery. You know, I'm way beyond that. But because it's all about the seasons, and it's about brokenness, and it's about healing as well. So some of you know, 13 years ago, I wrote a book on recovery. And I was going through recovery myself for a few years, and you never get out of that in the best sense. But I had written in my journal for 3 years, 400 entries that I, with people I met and stuff. And I had to choose from those entries to write this book. I felt God was leading me to write, but I didn't know how to organize it. And so why did I call it Beyond Humpty Dumpty? Some of you know. Because all the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty together again. We need to go beyond in our healing and recovery. And this is all of us here. If we have gone through life's difficult challenges, feeling battered, bruised, or broken, God's power is not interested in putting us back together again the way we used to be. That transforming power desires to take all the pieces of our lives and make a brand new creation, something we could never become if we had not been broken. That's it. We think, oh, I want to go back to the past. You know, I want to be what it was like, the good old days. Well, these are the good old days, right? God is creating everything new. And so I was so joyed when I thought, how do I organize this book? Then I realized I organized it around the four seasons. Because every day I walk on the path, and so I took 90 photographs. You know, I chose from them of the path, including this one. And so I called it Recovery Reflections on the Seasons of Our Lives. And so those of you who are in recovery know this, and it works for all of us. Spring is new life from near death. So spring, so I took the 12 steps and I divided them up. And so steps 1 to 3 in recovery and healing, and maybe for all of us, is give up, let go, let God. I can, he can, I think I'll let him. You know, just let God have control over our lives. That's what we're doing, right, as believers? And so that was step 1 to 3, to let go, let God. But then comes summer, which is the healing sunshine of summer, which is cleanup. And cleanup and recovery means make a list, you know, of your defects. Be willing to share with God, yourself, and another person the natures of your wrong. And then ask God, God, please come and remove these defects in my life for healing. And that's good for all of us, right? So that's called cleanup. And then autumn is makeup. This is getting ready for wintry times. Steps 8 and 9 in recovery for us in AA is making amends to those you've offended, asking forgiveness, even if they don't forgive you. It's just going and say, I messed up. I think I miss that most in the political race these days and in the last how many years. Can we ever just say we're sorry? Can we ever just say it's our fault? Can we ever just say I was wrong? Is that possible? I mean, that's how we grow as people. If we can't do that, if we always have to put other people down to lift ourselves up, how can we ever grow in our faith? How can we do that? And so we make up. We say we're wrong, we say we're sorry, I screwed up, I really blew it, I'm sorry, forgive me. And whether they do or not, that's not our thing, is it? It's what they decide to do. And then lastly, steps 10 to 12, keep up. Enjoy winter, this is, here's the secret, right? Enjoy winter by getting out into it. you can always put more clothes on, right? But you can't, you know, the other way. And so it's kind of like, you can thrive and survive and thrive in winter, but I know not all of you can get out in the winter and stuff, but we can bring snowballs in and, you know, things like that. So everything is beautiful in its own way. And as I thought about this and I thought about, you know, the reason I share my book and share my pottery is because those are the gifts God gave me to use to share my faith with others to encourage them, as you encourage me, right, with your faith. And so many years ago, I made this hand pot. Some of you have seen it. It's a hollow, the fingers are hollow and everything. I made everything on the wheel, these long cylinders, and I joined together in a hand. Then I made a pot and I broke the pot so it fitted to the hand. And I called the pot Broken But Held. broken. Our lives are broken, but God is holding us. We don't know what the future holds, but we know God holds the future. And so I wanted to make a base. Notice there's no base for this hand. And so I tried twice, and it didn't work. It cracked in the kiln, and some of you have even seen this in my last show last year. And on the left, these are supposed to be three pieces on top of each other to hold the hand. And the one says dust to dust, and the other says ashes to ashes, beloved. And then the one on the right says, from dust we came, to dust we return. So it was appropriate, wasn't it, that they break, that they became dust and ashes. And so it's like Ash Wednesday, isn't it? Remember the ashes, from dust we came, from dust we return. So I had to make a new base, and so I finally did. And I kind of tweaked it a little bit, and I said, but we are dust in the Master's hands, right? We're dust in the Master's hands. And so that became the base for my hand, which is in our house at time. So what does God say? He says, I'm making all things new, not just some things. Sometimes we still lament the past and we're ashamed of it, things we won't even tell our dog, you know. But God knows anyway. And so we can just let go, let God confess it. We can just say, thank you, Lord. You know, creating me a clean heart. Don't cast me away from your presence. You know, David knew God's presence. He's really strong. Remember when he played for King Saul, who was demon-possessed? He'd come and play his harp, and the demon would leave Saul. So David knew really well about the Spirit in him. Do not take your Holy Spirit from me, Lord. That's what he's crying out. So he makes all things new. My mother passed away 2 years ago. She was almost 97. She loved angels. She collected 100 different angels in her glass hutch in her room. And so we were so blessed when, after she died, that she had some money set aside for a tombstone. And we all contributed as four children, my sister had died. And we made this beautiful gravestone for my mom. And surrounded by her relatives, Sonnenbergs and Minkowskis, this is at St. John's Lutheran Cemetery in Fergus, Minnesota. Where most of our relationship is. Mother of Linda, Mike, Ken, Steve, and Mary. If you notice, she was a nurse. And my dad left her when she had five children, ages 2 through 12, that she had to raise on her own. It wasn't easy, and she was a nurse. And I talked to her later, she said she probably averaged 4 hours of sleep a night, you know, for decades, you know, just providing for the family. And it was pretty rough being. But when I took this picture, I didn't realize my sister Linda had died the year before, and my mother had a hard task of burying a child, which some of you know what that's like. It was so hard, but my sister loved hummingbirds. And so I think my younger sister Mary brought that hummingbird there on the left. You see that pink glass hummingbird just hovering there. And when I took the picture, I didn't realize till later, you notice that the hummingbird's shadow is falling right over my sister's name. And that was a sign. That was a sign for me and a sign for my siblings as well. Because there's a great promise, I include this verse in every funeral I've ever done. At the beginning, and I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. But it's not just when we die, is it? It's right now. Heaven begins now. That's why Paul wrote, we have a living hope. I love that from 1 Peter. So Peter wrote that. We have a living hope. And why is our hope living? Well, we have a living hope because the resurrection changes everything, doesn't it? Everything has become brand new. Yesterday's past. Today, it's like we were dead and now we're alive again. Right? And everything, every day is a blessing for us now. And so the closing slide, and some of you remember when Jesus let Lazarus die so he could come and he could raise him so others would believe in him. And Martha was struggling, of course, crying. And Jesus said to her, to Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die, and whoever lives by believing in me will never die. And then God says, Jesus says to Martha and says to us, do you believe this? And we say, Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief, right? Thank you, Jesus, for a life that will go on forever. You know, our last breath on earth will be our first breath in heaven, and we fall asleep and wake up in Jesus' arms. Praise God for that promise. Amen. Amen. Thank you. I have a few prayer requests here today, but I want to first begin with our really nice, responsive prayer for Labor Day. We're going to read it together responsibly, and then we'll do our couple specific prayers before our closing song. On this weekend, when we rest from our usual labors, loving Father, we pray for all who shoulder the tasks of human labor in the marketplace, in factories and offices, in the professions, and in family living. We thank you, Lord, for the gift and opportunity of our work. May our efforts always be pure of heart for the good of others and the glory of your name. We lift up to you all who long for just employment and those who work to defend the rights and needs of workers everywhere. May those of us who are now retired always remember that we still make a valuable contribution to our church and our world by our prayers and deeds of charity. May our working and our resting all give praise to you until the day we share together an eternal rest with all our departed in your kingdom, as you live and reign, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. I have a few prayers. We pray for Carol Fisher, worships and friends of many of you. She's having surgery on her ankles this morning, so we pray for her. Even now, thank God. I promised my younger brother Steve that he wrote yesterday an email that he's been doing this esophagus biopsy. He's had a lot of nodules and he's afraid that it's cancer. And he got word yesterday that it's not cancer. And I said, Steve will lift that up today for the prayer warriors to give thanks as well. Joan's mother contracted COVID last week, but she's healing, praise God. 92 years young. And we're praying for her as well. We're praying for her to come here to live as well, among all of you amazing people. So keep that in your prayers. We've already put a deposit down for that. I'm hoping for God's timing in that. And Joan's sister, Janet, she's been struggling with health issues, and praying for her and her children and her grandchildren, especially at this time. And so many other prayers, right? I mean, all of you, we could spend hours right now. But God knows our hearts, right? He knows our prayers, even before we speak. So let us include all these in the prayer he taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory, forever. Amen. May we work for the glory of God, so thank you. And also, God continues to work through us. So may the Lord bless us and keep us, and may his face shine upon us, be gracious unto us. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon us and give us his peace. Amen. We thank God for our country, and we definitely need to pray for our country this time.